10 most powerful extinct canid species. Canids of the Earth are powerful creatures, skilled hunters, vicious animals. Whether it be the African wild dog or the largest living canid, the grey wolf, these are animals that you don't want to get on the bad side of. But what about before all these living canids? What about the extinct canids that came before our modern canids, or perhaps lived alongside them? Were there any powerful canids that are now extinct? Any that were bigger than the ones we see today in the wild? Any canids that paved the way for the wolves and foxes and coyotes of today? Forget about the powerful living canids. What about the most powerful extinct canid species? Direwolf. You might think that direwolves are made up or only used in shows like Game of Thrones. But no, they existed and they were scary canids. Interestingly, direwolves lived in the Americas alongside grey wolves. The two were almost indistinguishable, many thought them to be the same. One key difference was that many canids, grey wolves included, would hybridize, mate with other species. Direwolves did no such thing. It is one reason many scientists believe they went extinct around 13,000 years ago, and grey wolves kept on living. Direwolves were comparable to grey wolves, but larger. They were a little over 3 feet tall at the shoulder and nearly 6 feet long. They were heavier and more muscular on average. The average direwolf was about 25% heavier than the average grey wolf, usually around 150 pounds, but plenty of them would have grown much heavier, the bigger ones topping 200 pounds. Their bones were larger, which made them broader and stockier as well. They might not have been quite as fast as a grey wolf, but if one caught you, believe us, it was over for you. But where did the direwolves come from? Armbruster's wolf. The direwolf was known as the most famous prehistoric carnivore, but it didn't just pop up out of nowhere. The ancestor of the direwolf, the one whose place it took, was known as the Armbruster's wolf. Armbruster's wolves also lived all throughout North America, but preceded the time of the direwolves. They lived during the Irvingtonian stage of the Pleistocene epoch. They spanned a great deal of time, from around 1.9 million years ago to about 250,000 years ago. In the grand scheme of things, that wasn't that long ago. But during the time in which the Armbruster's wolf lived, it was the largest canid on the planet. Nothing rivaled its size. In fact, it was even bigger than the grey wolf and the direwolf. They too stood about 3 feet high at the shoulder, and they could reach up to 7 feet in total length. Armbruster's wolves easily clocked in at 150 pounds on average, and plenty of them saw their weight exceed that. When you're the biggest canid on the planet, you wind up getting plenty of big meals. It is believed that these large wolves may have descended from something that crossed over from Asia. And another interesting fact about these wolves, though most canids are pack hunters, the Armbruster's wolf was likely a solitary hunter. If that's the case, and he didn't even need help from his pack, then he really was powerful. Xenocyon. Outside of North America, there were other powerful canids long ago. The Xenocyon didn't live in the Americas, but it showed up in plenty of other places. They roamed the lands of Europe, Africa, and Asia. There may have been distinctions between the Xenocyon on each continent, but they were all similarly sized to the Armbruster's wolves and direwolves. They were strong hunters, and they are important ancestors to today's modern canids. It is believed that Xenocyon paved the way for the evolution of dholes and African wild dogs. Yes, the Xenocyon is the ancestor of these dogs, living all the way back from the late Pliocene to the early Pleistocene. Xenocyon preyed on wild horses, baboons, antelopes, deer, and aurochs. They even went after larger prey like elephant calves, and it is strongly believed that they even preyed on humans. There was nothing a human could do to stop that attack. This canid's power was too overwhelming. Osbornodon Wangi. This next one actually lived in North America and lived a long time ago. It was Osbornodon Wangi. Osbornodon meaning Osborne's tooth, named after Henry Fairfield Osborne. Osbornodon lived from the Oligocene to the early Miocene. The span in which the Osbornodon lived was between about 33.9 million years ago to roughly 15.9 million years ago. The Osbornodon Wangi precedes the Armbruster's wolf by many millions of years. Now, this canid was smaller than wolves that we are talking about that came afterwards. They generally would have been between 50 to 80 pounds, but they used all of those 50 to 80 pounds and were extremely strong for their size. Though many humans would outweigh them, that would still not be an opponent that a human would desire. A carnivorous canid doesn't live on this planet for 18 million years without being good at hunting. In Hydrocyon. This next canid also lived in North America and during a similar range as the Osbornodon Wanji. We're talking about the Enhydrocyon, who lived between the Oligocene and early Miocene as well. Enhydrocyon span was from around 30.8 million years ago to 20.4 million years ago, almost 11 million years long. The interesting fact about Enhydrocyon is that this was a genus of bone-crushing canid. It was also a little smaller, 20 to 40 pounds, but with such strong jaws that its bite would crush the bones of its prey. Interestingly enough, it wasn't a strict carnivore. It was either a hypercarnivore, meaning it ate over 70% meat, or a mesocarnivore, meaning it ate between 50 to 70% meat, the rest of its diet coming from fungi, fruits, and other plant material. Enhydrocyon had a short snout and strong jaws, similar to that of a jaguar. Makes sense. The jaguar has one of the strongest bites among felines and the entire animal kingdom. It is said the shape of the skull of Enhydrocyon was like that of a sea otter. According to fossil evidence, Enhydrocyon was found in places in the US like Oregon, Nevada, Utah, Colorado, Nebraska, Arkansas, Mississippi, Alabama, and Florida, to name a few places. It may have been less widespread than Osbornodon, it may have been smaller and lived for less time, but it sure packed a punch with those powerful jaws. Eleurodon taxoids. The next canid we're taking a look at is Eleurodon taxoids, which was another bone-crushing canid. They're often called hyena-like dogs, as they share the similarities of spotted hyenas with the ability to crush bones with that famous and powerful bite. Eleurodon taxoids also lived throughout much of central and western United States. However, Eleurodon had a much different time span in which he roamed North America. Eleurodon had no overlap with Enhydrocyon, and just the slightest overlap with Osbornodon, essentially picking up where they left off. That was about 10.7 million years in which Eleurodon roamed North America, wisely avoiding the competition from these other canids before him. Eleurodon was probably about 80 pounds on average, sometimes exceeding that. They were skilled pack hunters, much like modern wolves. They feasted on animals larger than them, still able to pull them down with their excellent strength and snapping right through the bones. Fossils have been found in modern-day Florida, Texas, New Mexico, and Kansas, to name a few places, so the prey animals in the Miocene in those areas were not the luckiest animals around. Protopician Rachi. One of the top predators of its time was Protopician Rachi, another canid that roamed North America. Many remains of Protopician Rachi have been found in California and New Mexico, and the fossils from those states have allowed scientists to learn much about them. These canids were also around 80 pounds or so, and extremely successful hunters with their powerful jaws and fast, muscular bodies built for endurance. They lived between 16 million years ago to 13.6 million years ago. They lived during the Barstovian stage of the Middle Miocene epoch. But there is something extremely important about Protopician Rachi. They are believed to be the ancestor of another canid, a much larger and more powerful canid. But which canid is that exactly? Molossus. The Molossus is next up, and yes, it does sound humongous as its name is close to Colossus. It was humongous, but it's not the canid we were mentioning that Protopician Rachi was the ancestor to. However, Molossus was massive. These were strong and muscular dogs that were popular thousands of years ago, and many believe they are partially responsible for all the mastiff breeds today. Makes sense. They look quite similar. The name Molossus comes from the kingdom of Molossia in Italy, where they were popular. These dogs served as guard dogs for the Roman army. Their size alone was enough to scare off enemies, and if the enemies weren't scared off, well, this dog wasn't all bark and no bite. They had bite and muscle that may have rivaled the weight of full-grown men. Barophagus diversidens. That Roman guard dog was a scary sight, but to get back to the continent of North America, canids there got bigger, much bigger. A great example of this was Barophagus diversidens, whose name said it all. The translation is devouring glutton. And how do you get to be a devouring glutton when living in the wild? You had to be either a great hunter or an excellent scavenger. And Barophagus diversidens figured to be both, but many believe they thrived off scavenging. They were huge, averaging around 200 pounds, and they had extremely powerful jaws along with a bulging forehead. They were easy to pick out of a crowd. The crowd they lived in was during the Middle Miocene epoch and all the way through to the Pleistocene epoch. The range was about 12 million years ago to 1.8 million years ago, and they're closely related to today's modern dog. Although much larger than most breeds, obviously. But as big as Barophagus diversidens was, he wasn't the biggest and most powerful. He wasn't the canid we alluded to earlier, that which Protopithecine raci was an ancestor to. No, there was another canid even bigger. Epicion haydeni. The largest canid to ever exist was Epicion haydeni. Epicion haydeni was also from the Barophagini subfamily, so he too was a bone-crushing dog. It's unfair to add the bone-crushing ability along with its massive size. Epicion had a shoulder height of about 3 feet, but one of the most impressive things about it was its length. This canid was 8 feet long on average, and the average weight was between 250 to 275 pounds. However, oftentimes they exceeded 300 pounds, and the heaviest known Epicion was 375 pounds. For comparison, the largest living canid is the grey wolf. The biggest grey wolves recorded are around 180 pounds. Here's the best comparison to a modern day animal. Jaguars reach 8 feet long, and they are usually 150 to 300 pounds. So imagine a canid that is as long as a jaguar, weighs about as much as a jaguar, but in plenty of cases weighs more. Now add onto the jaguar's powerful bite and give it a more powerful bite with the ability to crush bones, and then remember, this is an endurance hunter. It will track you, chase you down, and you will get tired long before it does. A killing machine. Epicion, which means more than a dog, lived for about 15 million years in North America during the Miocene epoch. That means the worst place to live if you were a tasty-looking animal to a canid was North America during the Miocene epoch. No wonder Epicion haydeni lived so long. Who's going to stop a nearly 400-pound bone-crushing canid? No one. And that is why they were the largest and most powerful canid of all time.